Hello, my name is Jan Egil Ring. Welcome to my session where I will show you how you can become an effective Azure administrator by using PowerShell. We'll start out by looking at some tooling, such as the Windows terminal and some customizations of the prompt, the profile, and so on. Next, we'll dive into Azure Cloud Shell and specifically look at a new feature called VNet integration. Next, we will spend most of the time looking at containers and how we can leverage those with regards to Azure administration and automation. And at the end, we will spend a few minutes looking at some examples on how we can leverage PowerShell in combination with Azure event-driven automation. So that was all of my slides. The remaining part of the session will be all demos. So let's head over to VS Code. So if we start with the tooling, I suppose most of the people attending this conference knows that Windows PowerShell is deprecated and it's only being provided security fixes and so on. So the future and the development, current active development of PowerShell resides in the new PowerShell Core or PowerShell 7, which is the latest version. So all of the demos in this session will be based on PowerShell 7, the latest version at the time of the recording, which is 7.1.3. I have left some links to information about how to install it and so on, in case you have not used it before. Windows Terminal is another very useful tool for those who are running Windows. So if you are not used that before, you can find it on the Microsoft Store. I have already installed it, as you can see, but you can just go ahead and search in the upper right corner for Windows Terminal and install it. Then it will be automatically populated, the profile list here, with the available versions. So for example, Windows PowerShell, CMD and Azure Cloud Shell is available by default. But if you install, for example, PowerShell 7 or you install Windows Subsystem for Linux, Ubuntu in my case, then those will also be detected and automatically populated in this list. You can also go into settings and add your own custom profiles. For example, here, like I have added one for SSH access directly to a specific server in my lab environment. So this is fully customizable. We'll look into the settings shortly. First, I wanted to show you how you can customize your prompt. For example, here you can see that the Azure icon is here, and this text is the display name of the current active Azure subscription. So the way you can set up this, it's not very hard. There is this PowerShell module called OhMyPosh. So if you go into the documentation for the prompt theme engine, it can be used in PowerShell and, as you can see here, a lot of other shells as well. If you go into the documentation, you can see how you can install it on the different operating systems. It's basically just a PowerShell module when you're using PowerShell. There is also a lot of themes available. So for example, if you run this command, you can get a list of all of the built-in themes. So here you can either just find one that you like, or you can customize and build your own. And there are also various segments available here. Here you can see, for example, for Azure, a sample configuration that can, as I mentioned, display the currently active Azure subscription. There are also a lot of other segments available for different cloud providers and tools, Terraform, kubectl for Kubernetes and so on. So this is something that you can build up based on your own personal preferences. So you can see in my case, I am using the Azure one, also which folder I'm currently active in. And I'm also having, for example, the kubectl extension. So if I'm connected to a Kubernetes cluster, the name of the currently active context for kubectl will also be displayed in the middle there. So this is something that I would highly recommend to just spend a few minutes if you're using some of the built-in themes. You don't have to use a lot of time, but it's highly worth it because it provides a very quick and valuable information on the command line. There is also an important aspect when you are going to use, for example, you can see here we have some icons available. These are called glyphs. So you need to install a font that supports these glyphs or icons. So Trevor Sullivan from the PowerShell community, he have a very good video where he shows you how you can customize your PowerShell prompt with so-called nerd fonts that is required in order to these icons to work. So I left a link here. I think it's not very long. It's 17 minutes. So that's time well spent. Next is a kind of practical tip when you're working with, for example, different environments, or if you are like me, that you are working with different customers, maybe multiple customers within a single day, then it's very important to have a clarity about the current context. For example, you are authenticated to various customers using both the Azure CLI, kubectl, Azure PowerShell, and it's very important to have a clean environment so that you don't by mistake run a command in the wrong environment. That could be very bad. So one approach, we're going to look at the multiple ones, but one approach that I use personally for ad hoc administration is within VSL or Windows Subsystem for Linux to create multiple users so that I have a clean working environment. So if you noticed when we looked at the profile list here, you could see that I had VSL profiles for different customers. So I can show you how you can set up such user. So you just start out by logging into the default VSL user when you install, for example, Ubuntu from the Microsoft Store. After you have installed VSL, you have root access here. So you can just go ahead and add users like you regularly do. So for example, give it a logical name, for example, the customer name or something meaningful. If you're not working with different customers, you could, for example, have one profile per environment. So if you have separate Azure environments for test, QA, production, and so on, you could have different environments and different colors on the tabs here to separate the environments. So let's just go ahead and create this user, Contoso. When that is created, we can create a new profile in VSL. So let's go ahead and create a new GUID, and we can launch the settings file. Currently, there is a settings.json file that you need to manipulate. They are working on a graphical user interface for the Windows terminal settings, but currently you have to manipulate the JSON file directly. So if you scroll down here, you can see, for example, if you copy customer 2, just select all of the text here. And we can call it Contoso. And the GUID here needs to be unique within Windows Terminal so it can differentiate the profile. So we'll just insert the value from the new GUID command. So the final thing we need to adjust here is what kind of user do you want to start. So we're basically just starting VSL from the command line, selecting which distribution we want to run, what user we want to launch VSL as. So Contoso, which is the one we just created. And finally, what command shell we want to use. So here I have pre-installed PowerShell 7 inside Ubuntu using the root user, so it's accessible to all users. And I want that to be the default shell for this Contoso user. So when we save this file, go back to Windows Terminal, it should have picked up that we now have a new profile. So if we go into this, you can see that it's launched in a new tab. Here you can also customize, for example, the icon instead of the Linux Penguin logo. You could, for example, have the customer logo or some other meaningful logo there. If you close the settings file, the next thing I regularly do is to create a profile file for the user, because here you can see that it has brought a mounted file system from my host machine into the VSL environment. And if you look at the environment variable and specifically the path, uh, And let's expand it to value so you can see it. So here you can see that it has actually inherited a lot of paths from the host, for example, Git, and a lot of other paths that is inherited from the environment on my local user. And this is not so desired always, because, for example, I've seen it sometimes that when this folder for the Azure CLI is brought in here, it's also bringing in the context. So I'm automatically authenticated using the same Azure CLI user that I have locally on my machine. And that's kind of against the purpose of creating this user. So what I normally do is I create a new PowerShell profile and clean out all of the host related paths. So remove everything starting with /MNT. So I only keep the built-in Windows paths. So first we go ahead and create a PowerShell profile to accomplish that. Let's just create it because it doesn't exist by default. Go into the VI editor and we can insert I for insert and the contents from this example profile. So here you can see that I'm using regular PowerShell syntax to just remove everything started with the MNT that is mounted from the host. Next, I'm also importing a helper module I like to use, which is a completer for native Linux commands that is very useful, and I customize the PS readline a little bit. So let's just copy this and paste it into the profile. Escape, VQ to save and quit. And let's just exit and reopen the profile. And now you can see that it's not by default going into the folder that was mounted. And if you also have a look at this, you can see that now it's much cleaner. It's only the Linux environment. So now we have, for example, installed the AC module. So when I authenticate here using my customer account, we need to use device authentication when it's when there are no browser available. So when I authenticate here, it is the credentials are saved into the user profile of this isolated user. So then it's very easy to just switch between the different profiles and be sure that you have a clean working environment only related to that customer. So that was the first tip. I also installed a few modules as root. This is also kind of a personal preference. In my case, I'm using the root user to install all of this module, AC module, PS readline, the latest version, and this Unix completers module for all users. But for example, if you for some reason need to have different AC module versions per customer, you can of course install it into the current user profile instead of all users. So this is kind of up to you. So that was it for the tooling part on Windows Terminal. Next is PowerShell itself on the host. So if you have a quick look here at my current PowerShell profile setup, the only thing I have in my profile is importing this PS profile module. And this is a really handy module created by a community member, which is built for a cross-platform profile customization. So you have some great documentation on the project page here. So you can see how you can install it, that everything you need to do is to have this line in your PowerShell profile in order to load it. You can either tweak things manually by running all of these commands and adding scripts and modules you want to install and import and so on, or you can run through this configuration helper to and just follow the prompts in order to do the initial customization. So we can have a look here, for example, if we open my PS profile configuration and have a look here, you can see that I have, for example, defined some aliases here, modules that I want to be automatically imported, such as omiposh that we talked about earlier, for one module for kubectl completion, some scripts that I want to get automatically imported, and a lot of other things here. But some of the scripts, we can have a look at one of them. Let's close this one and open the correct file. So here is an example file that is loaded via PS profile. So for example, here you can see that I have done some regular PowerShell profile customization, for example, to set the error foreground color to white, so that when I write some error in PowerShell, I don't get this red text and instead get the white text, so my colleagues don't think I do any mistakes ever. So that is just some regular profile customizations. Yeah, default parameter values, forcing TLS 1.2, that is also a good idea now, because for example, I think GitHub and a few other common sources are forcing TLS, so if you don't have that set, it will fail to download, for example, a zip file and so on. And just some regular customizations, so PS read line and so on. So the point is here that using PS profile, I can just import this single module in my actual profile and load all of the other customizations from various helper scripts or define it in the PS profile customization. So I've used this for, I think, a couple of years now, and I use GitHub to store my all of my files, so the profile, PS profile configuration file and all of these helper scripts, they are stored in a GitHub repository. So when I'm logging into a new computer, for example, I have one desktop and one laptop. I also log into various management servers at the different customers. Then I can just clone my regular PowerShell repository from GitHub. You can also store it in OneDrive or Dropbox or whatever works for you. And then I typically set up symbolic links. So for example, if I have my Git repository or my PowerShell repo stored in cgit or wherever it is, just point to profile.ps1 and create a symbolic link to the my documents path, because as you probably know, PowerShell is looking at this specific folder, documents, and then PowerShell for PowerShell 6 and 7, and Windows PowerShell for the good old Windows PowerShell. So I've set up symbolic links for both, so I have the same profile, regardless of whether I'm using PowerShell 7 or if I'm using Windows PowerShell, I get the same profile. So that's kind of a great tip, I believe, that you can use this approach to synchronize your personal preferences on the profile. I think it was yesterday, the day before I recorded this session, Steve Lee from the PowerShell team had a great blog post regarding how you can optimize your profile. So this is also an interesting read. He's actually storing profile PS1 in his GitHub account and set up some thread job that makes the REST call to GitHub to retrieve the latest version of his profile. And he also talks a little bit about how we can baseline the profile and get a heat map on what is the slowest parts and so on. So this is a highly recommended read. Next up regarding tooling is Azure Tools. I suppose you are familiar with the Azure PowerShell module. If you're not, the AC module that works both on Windows PowerShell and the new PowerShell 6 and 7 versions. So if you are new, I have left some information here for reference, because if you have a brand new, for example, Windows 10 computer and you have never used PowerShell before, and you, for example, have installed PowerShell 7 but never installed a module or anything, then there are some default settings that can prevent you from installing the module. So for reference, I have left some information here about configuring the execution policy in PowerShell so that you are actually allowed to install the module. Some examples on how you can authenticate using a credential object, how you can store it to disk and import it so you don't have to authenticate every time. But as we saw, if you're using PowerShell 6 or 7, device authentication is required. So this means that you will get a URL and a code, so you have to log into that URL with your Azure account. If you are using MFA, you will also be, of course, prompted for that if you are not already authenticated. So this is just some references for how you basically, the basics of authenticating and installing the module. Next, which I have talked about briefly, is the importance of showing what context you are working with. So Get AC context will show you the current active subscription, but if you have access to more than one subscription, you can list those using Get AC subscription and change between it using Set AC context. And of course, if you want to disconnect, you can do that. But in my experience, it's something that you typically can forget when working on multiple environments or multiple customers from the local machine. So the approach of using, for example, VSL for interactive command line prompts, that can be one idea. Azure Cloud Shell, that we'll talk about in the next topic, can be another. So when you're authenticated, of course, the commands will just work against the current context. So you can, for example, list VMs, create VMs, and so on and so forth. Another tool, even though we are PowerShell fans and want to use PowerShell and the object orientation and so on, the Azure CLI is also quite handy to have installed. For example, if you're using Terraform, that requires that you are using Azure CLI to authenticate to Azure and set a current context, because Terraform will perform any action against the current context of the Azure CLI. And it's also very useful to just know a little bit about the CLI and use it. There are some scenarios there where you can't use PowerShell. For example, Azure DevOps have an extension in AC CLI. I'm not sure if there actually are an official Microsoft Azure DevOps extension. I know there are a community module, but yeah. Also some examples here regarding miscellaneous recommendations. For example, in PS Readline, there is this great new feature in PS Readline, which was introduced in November last year with predictive intelligence. So I've been using this for since it was released in November, and I'm sure it has saved me hours because it's so useful. So here you can see that when it's just starting to type get-ch, it will auto-complete based on either from the history or a plugin, which we'll talk more about, but I'm using it mainly from the history, the PS Readline history. So basically all commands that I've written before. So this can save you a lot of time. So for example, if you go into here and I type, for example, a Docker command, you can see that I get all of this auto-completion suggestions based on things that I have, commands that I've written earlier on. So this is a huge, huge time saver. Very easy to set up as well. Just install 2.1.0 or the latest preview of PS Readline, and then set the PS Readline option to prediction source history. This is one of the lines that I had in my profile that you saw earlier on, because by default it's set to none. Also make sure to check out the AC predictor. So this is a plugin for the new feature. So basically what it does, we can have a quick look at this article. A new preview was released back in March. So here you can see the same thing basically, that you can get intelligence both from the history, as we saw in my example, but also from the AC predictor. So when you just start typing, for example, new AC, and then it will suggest things based on AI basically. So here you can see how you can install it. The latest preview of the module unfortunately requires PowerShell 7.2 preview 3, so I can't use it in my regular environment where I prefer to not use any preview versions, but it's rather easy to spin up a container or test it out in a different environment. This command will actually import the module and add it to your PowerShell profile. Talking about how to customize and optimize VS Code for PowerShell, it's a topic for a whole dedicated session. So that is something that Justin Grote already done. So I have linked a great session of his here where we are going through a lot of the things that you can configure in the VS Code settings regarding PowerShell. So here is also a link to the examples from that session of his, where we are talking about, we have actually commented every setting on, for example, what they are doing. And of course, this is opinionated, so it's up to you, but I think it's a great starting point. There are especially one important setting here, which is editor.snippet suggestions, because you might have noticed sometimes that when you type, for example, new file share, and here IntelliSense pops up with some snippets instead of the PowerShell commands. So when that happens, typically I have to type control space in order to actually get the PowerShell IntelliSense, because it timed out for some reason. But if you have not configured the setting I mentioned, instead of just not showing anything, it will show a lot of snippets here, and that can be rather annoying when you are expecting that the PowerShell IntelliSense should pop up and you get some snippets that is not relevant instead. So that is some small details that can be annoying when using VS Code and the PowerShell extension, that can be solved by just tuning some of the configuration files. So make sure to check out this video and the examples from Justin. Okay, so let's dive into the next topic, which is Azure Cloud Shell. I suppose most of you are familiar with it. In case you are not, I have left some references here to the official documentation and some information about where it can be accessed from, for example, the portal. And using the Azure extension in VS Code, you can actually go ahead and open it here as well. If you just search for Cloud Shell, you can open either PowerShell or Bash in Cloud Shell, and it will open here as a terminal tab. One of the main benefits is that you are automatically authenticated to the Azure environment with the same user that you are logging into the portal. So for example, here I have started a session where I have hit this button in order to start the Cloud Shell. When that is has started, you can go ahead and open up this VS Code like editor in here as well. Can close it, so you can see how it, this is how it looks when you have just clicked this button. But you can expand this and make it larger and hit this button to open up the editor, so you can store files inside of your cloud drive, because the files you store here is persistent. Those are stored in a Azure file share, but all of the remaining of the environment, it's basically a container that is spun up for you when you are starting Cloud Shell. So here, let's go back to the demo code. Here is just some general examples regarding how you can use Cloud Shell and the various commands, for example, for running PowerShell commands, using the run command extension for virtual machines, what kind of tools is available, and so on. But the topic for this session is to look at this new feature called Deploy Cloud Shell into an Azure Virtual Network. This is something that was generally available, I would believe it was in December of 2020, and it actually allows you, you have to deploy some additional resources here, such as Azure Relay Service and some specific subnets in a virtual network. Then when you log into Cloud Shell and have configured this integration, an Azure Container instance, an ACI instance or ACI container will be spun up into the VNet that you have defined, and then you will have access to everything that is inside of that virtual network. So here is some documentation for the things I just mentioned. So this is the screenshot from the first time you launch Cloud Shell. So when you hit this button, you will get this experience. So if you have already configured Cloud Shell and started using it without the integration, you can simply type Cloud Drive Unmount and relaunch Cloud Shell. Then you will get back to this experience. Here you can see these advanced settings where you can specify VNet isolation settings, where you select Cloud Shell region, the resource group, where you have provisioned a storage account for your Azure File Share, which is your profile, as I just mentioned, and also the virtual network that you have prepared with the specific network profile and the relay namespace that was outlined in the documentation. So in order to set up and configure all of this, I have provided some example code here where we create our resource group and deploy this template that they have in the as a quick start example, and deploy it. So here you have the JSON file for the setup that I performed. So here I created this specific subnet, which are required for the different services, ACI and so forth. So this is already run because it takes some time, and I've also run the first run experience. So now this container or this Azure Cloud Shell actually has an IP address within the virtual network. So this we can test by trying to access a virtual machine that resides in this West Europe network, a different subnet dedicated for VMs, and we can try to access it by this private IP address. I did some work in the beginning to try to get VSMAN-based remoting to work, because as you can see here, this is a Windows-based server. So I wanted to try to see if I could get VSMAN-based remoting to work. So here you can see a very great article by Jordan Baron, which is a community member who has created this PaaS-VSMAN module, and he is explaining everything about using VSMAN on Linux, and it's a very comprehensive and great article with all of the details regarding what is missing and so on, and what he has created in his PaaS-VSMAN module, where he has filled a lot of the gaps. So I tried to install this locally on my machine. Everything worked fine from Linux, from VSL or the Ubuntu instance we talked about earlier on. But unfortunately, there are some issues getting it working properly in Azure Cloud Shell because some of the dependencies are missing, such as for either you want to use Kerberos or NTLM, some of the prerequisites are not available. And you also can't install them because we do not have root access or administrative permissions inside of the Cloud Shell container. So I submitted an issue to Cloud Shell to ask them to add this package so that NTLM will work at least, but don't think it has been looked into yet. So in order to get things working, I had to install OpenSSH and enable SSH-based remoting on this server. So I can use PowerShell 7 and regular SSH-based remoting instead. How you do that is outlined in the documentation for PowerShell. So that means that we should be able to use enter PaaS-session and instead of computer name, which will use VSMAN authentication or the VSMAN protocol, when we instead use dash hostname, it will use SSH authentication. And then we specify the username. Since I have not configured any SSH keys here, I will be prompted for the super secret password in this lab environment. And I should get access. So now I am within Cloud Shell and using PowerShell Remoting to access a virtual machine here. And here I could of course use this as a jump box and use enter PaaS-session or invoke command and whatnot in order to use VSMAN-based remoting to other internal servers. In addition to PowerShell Remoting, of course, you could have kubectl in order to access a private AKS cluster, basically access anything that is configured behind a private endpoint in Azure. So this is a rather cool, great new feature. One gotcha is that when you start it, as it says here, this may take several minutes, and it actually does. I can't recall if I recorded it, but I believe it's 2 or 3 minutes instead of maybe 20 seconds or something in a regular Cloud Shell, so that is kind of a gotcha. But besides that, it has worked great. Okay, so let's dive into the next topic, which is the containers. Here we'll talk about Docker, which as you probably know is the fastest way to containerize applications. I've just included some links to the downloads for the different operating systems and assume that you have Docker installed if you're going to follow along with the demos. So Docker Hub, you can think of it like the PowerShell gallery for containers. It's where you share and can download container images. So for example, if we search for PowerShell here, we can find the official PowerShell image. And here you can see the full tag listing for example, all of the Windows images, all of the Linux images, and see what specific versions you want to download. For example, the latest preview of 7.2, which is preview 4. If you go back here, you can, if you just do a basic demo first, where we do Docker run and run a container image interactively, using Azure CLI image as an example. Here we specify IT for interactive and RM for automatically removing the container after we exit it, so it's not lingering around. So if you just go ahead and run this, you can see that now we have the container up and running, and we have access to the latest version of the Azure CLI immediately. If we have a quick look here, Docker PS shows us that now this has started a few seconds ago. This is a different container that I already had running. If we go exit from this, you should see that it's been removed automatically as we specified with this parameter. If you don't manually run Docker pull before you use the image, it will also be automatically pulled when you do, when you use it in Docker run, for example. So it's not necessary, but if you want to have it manually, you can. Here's another example of using the PowerShell 7.2 preview image that we just talked about. So here we can just I run this before, so it should fire up rather immediately, this as well. So here you can see that we now have access in a few seconds to the latest and greatest version of PowerShell, and we can test out new features and try things out without having to clutter our local workstation or laptop. Next, I wanted to talk about containers in general. They are ephemeral, so everything that you do inside of a container, it's lost if it's not stored to persistent storage. Here is an example of how you can map a local folder to the container. So in this example, the cgit folder will be locked in, will be mapped into the /local folder inside of the container. So I can use that folder to persist data between usage of the folder or of the container. Yeah, this is just for reference, basically how you tag if you create some custom containers, container images, how you tag them and push them to a private repository on Docker Hub or Azure Container Registry, for example. What I wanted to talk about specifically in this session is remote containers or dev containers. This is a really useful feature available in Visual Studio Code. So I can show you first how you create a skeleton. So if you just create a blank folder and open VS Code inside of this folder. Here we are assuming that we have the remote containers extension already installed. So if you go here, you can see that remote containers, it's already installed. So that's the extension that we are going to use for this demo. So if you have a look here and hit remote containers from the command palette, here you can see that we have one shortcut called add development container configuration files. So if we use this one, we can select some skeleton predefined container definitions where they have predefined for specific languages and so on. In this case, I'm just choosing Alpine since it's the smallest. And here you can see that you get this .dev container subfolder with a dev container.json file, which have some metadata about what is the name of the Docker file, this one, which version do we want of the image, what integrated shell do we want as the default, what VS Code extensions do we want, and what user do we want to run. So in this example, it's using a container image that is pre-built as a template, but of course here you can just go ahead and build a Docker file on your own, adding tools that you want, for example Azure CLI and other tools. So let's just close out this one and look at one that we have pre-built before. So if we go here and just remove that one and open the file that we have in this demo repository that you will have access to after the session. We have to go into the correct folder. Let's see. And then open the Docker file. So here you can see that I have done some customizations. I started out by trying the Alpine image, but the advantage is that it's very, very small and fast and lightweight and all of that. But it's also kind of limited with regards to when you want to do customizations and install packages and customize the environment, basically. Then I found the Ubuntu image to be more customizable, so I switched to that, even though it's a little bit larger. I also disabled this part, which will basically install the latest updates for the operating system for the sake of the demo, but for real use it's best practice to have this enabled. Next, I'm using the PSDepend PowerShell module in order to install the PowerShell modules that I want to have inside of the container. So this is basically pointing to this file where all of the modules that I want to have installed inside the container image is defined. Next, I'm also installing the Azure CLI. So here is just an reference to the documentation. So I just inserted the commands to install Azure CLI on Ubuntu. And at the end, I have switched to a non-root, a non-root user, because it's best practice to not run your container as a root user. So I'm just creating a new user, in this case called VS Code, and specifying that we want to use that one. We also have this devcontainer.json file. So here you can put in some metadata about your dev container. So you can give it a custom name. I'm pointing to PowerShell, of course, as the shell that I want to use. And I'm also installing some extensions that I want to use in this environment, such as the PowerShell extension, of course, Azure Account and Terraform. So here you can have specific extensions for the specific dev containers that you create. For example, as mentioned previously, you can have one dev container per customer or per environment, and so on and so forth. Remote user VS Code. So that's basically it. So when this has been created, I can just go ahead and press F1, remote containers, and choose the rebuild and reopen in container. Then it will go ahead and run Docker build against this Docker file. So the image will be created locally on my machine, and it will restart VS Code and attach it to a running instance of that container. So let's go ahead and start that. It does take a few seconds to do it the first time. Now I run it just before this demonstration, so it's rather quick now, but when there is no cached copy, it can take some time. So here you can see that I'm now inside of the dev container on the bottom left. Here you can see that the workspaces mount point is automatically, it has automatically mounted my local folder into the container. So I didn't have to do anything manually, as you saw in the initial example where we had to use this special syntax to map a local folder into the container. It's just taken care of. So if you have a look here, we have access to all of the files that we had locally. So it's the same directory structure, but it's running inside of the container. So that we can verify by running hostname, for example. It has a random name as the hostname. So now I have access to the modules and such that I specified in the setup. So here you can see, for example, PS readline and all of the other things that I have defined there is already available. If we go to this part, we can see, for example, if we run get AC context, that we don't have any Azure context because this is a brand new context. So what you can do is to use connect AC account as normally you do, authenticate, and then you can use save AC context to persist the context into a file in the mapped folder. So dev container, I've created a folder called PowerShell, Azure, and then a JSON file containing my credentials. So the next time, if you imagine that I now close the container and start it again, so it will be started from scratch, then you can imagine that the AC context will be blank. Then you can simply just import it again using import AC context. This you can of course do automatically in a PowerShell profile or some custom logic, so you don't have to do it manually as I do now. And then you can see the context is already then there. You are authenticated and you can start using GetAC VM, for example, and the other Azure PowerShell modules. The same is true for Azure CLI. It's also storing the credentials in a JSON file in this folder. So you can do some logic to copy this file into the correct location, basically, so you don't have to authenticate every time. So this is an example of a custom container that I built using just the PowerShell, Azure PowerShell image as a starting point. But what is also possible is to use the Cloud Shell image, because they have published that. It's available on GitHub. So if you go in here, you can see the Azure Cloud Shell image with all of the build files and instructions on how to download it and run it locally. So this means that we, instead of building everything ourselves, we can actually just leverage the Cloud Shell image. Then we have the CLI, Terraform, Ansible, and all of the other commands, that the command line tools that are available in Cloud Shell, in our local dev container. So that's a great starting point. So if you go into dev container, you can see that I created some skeletons here as well, dockerfile underscore cloud shell. Just copy this into the dockerfile and rebuild it. And then you basically run it from the latest version of Cloud Shell, which is, I think it's updated on a monthly cadence. And then you can also see that I removed the part that installed the Azure CLI, because it's included in the Cloud Shell image, so you don't have to do it. The only thing I do here is to just install the PowerShell modules that I wanted. One gotcha there is regarding the size of the container image. The Cloud Shell image is rather huge. I was kind of surprised when I saw it the first time that the image size is 9.3 gigabytes, I believe. So I started creating an issue and asked around, and then I started to look more detailed into it using ncgu, which is a command line tool to see per folder basically what is consuming the space. So here you can see, if you scroll down, that for example the Azure function call tools and the chef workstation alone is more than 1.2 gigabyte. So it's just be aware of that it's a huge image, but you get a lot of tools inside of it. One other cool feature is something called GitHub Code Spaces. This is currently in preview, a closed beta. Let's just reopen this locally so my start process links works. If you go here again and have a quick look, here you can also see that when I open a folder that has .dev container subfolder, it prompts me, do you want to reopen it in a container? So that's also very handy. Let's see. Yeah, so as I started to talk about, Code Spaces is an online development environment. So the container is not running on your local machine, it's hosted by GitHub, and Visual Studio Code is basically hooking into a remote instance of a container. So it's kind of a cloud development environment. It also has its own VS Code extension, so when you have installed that, you get this GitHub Code Spaces option, and here you can basically hit connect and you will get the same experience as you did with the dev containers, except that it's connecting to a remote container instead of a local one. So this is great, for example, if you are working with from many different machines and you want to have a central location for your dev environment instead of having it tied to a local physical machine, for example. So this is also a good option to be aware of. A concept in GitHub code spaces is dot files. So that is basically a repository in your GitHub profile called dot files that Visual Studio code spaces looks for. And this will also work with dev containers. So in here, it will look for the specific file. So here I just cloned Tyler Leonard's dot files repository as a starting point and customized it. So for example, it will look for install.sh, and from here we're calling some commands to, for example, install and customize PowerShell as we regularly do using a PowerShell profile, for example. All right. There are also just for reference that there are also extensions for connecting to VSL from within Visual Studio Code. So the environment that you have here, you can connect to it and use it from Visual Studio Code. And another useful one is remote SSH. So if you have access to some management workstations, for example, instead of RDPing into the servers, you can just make sure that OpenSSH is installed and running on the machine and use remote SSH extension from VS Code and use it from your local machine and have network connectivity to everything that the management server have. That's also a great tip, I believe. The final topic is event-based automation. Since we don't have so much time to cover everything in 45 minutes and we're running low on time now, I'll just leave this here as a reference. But we can have a quick look at the logs and talk about the concept. So it's basically using Event Grid subscriptions to trigger Azure functions in order to do some automated actions. The example here is to apply automated tags. So for example, when someone is creating a new resource in Azure, you can use this technique to automatically tag resources with a creator. There is a great example here that I've been used as a template myself, which explains the concept that I just talked about, and also have the code, a boilerplate code that you can use in an Azure function in order to do it. Here you can also see how you are creating the event grid subscription and so on. And also just as a reference, Azure Policy can also do a lot of things. So for example, instead of creating a created on date using Azure function, it might be easier to just do it using Azure Policy, because Azure Policy actually have some built-in functions. So in this example where we want to create a created on date, there is a built-in function called UTC now, which you can use in order to timestamp the created on date tag. So the logic here says that if it does not exist, just created with this as the value. That's much faster and cleaner than creating the same logic in PowerShell. So basically the message is use the tool for the right tool for the job. So that's it for this session. Let's go into the summary. What we have looked at here is some tooling. We started looking around at the Windows Terminal, the different tools we have available for working with Azure. We talked a little bit about the new predictor capabilities in PS Readline, and I showed you a little bit about a tip how we can use profiles within VSL in order to separate environments to work with different customers if you're a consultant, for example. We also looked a little bit about into Azure Cloud Shell and looked at the new VNet integration feature. Then we dived a little bit into containers, and we started out by just playing around with the PowerShell image, the Azure CLI image. Then we talked about the Azure PowerShell image and created a dev container based on that. And at the end, I just showed you an example how we can use the Cloud Shell image and as a base image, and then do customizations on top of that, so you get your own custom environment that you can use with all predefined tools that are available in Cloud Shell. inside of a dev container. So even though the image is rather huge, 9 gigabytes, that's a huge size for a container image, you can use, of course, the same image across all of your customers or across all of your environments. So you don't have to spend 9 gigabytes for each. At the end, we also touched briefly into event-driven automation, just to give you an idea on how we can use PowerShell to automate event-driven actions in your environment. For example, automated tagging and so on. So that's it from me. I hope you learned it was useful for you. The demonstrations and this slide deck is available on this URL. Feel free to contact me via Twitter or email if you have any questions. So thank you very much.